Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Walt Kosmowski from BevCam, and I'd like to welcome all our viewers out there on a very beautiful midsummer evening to this special concert with the Quintessential Brass right behind me. This is a special concert dedicated to our seniors that's produced by, sponsored by the Mayor's Office and the Beverly Council on Aging. So without further ado, I would like to have you meet and greet the Quintessential Brass.
Mask on?
No mask.
Look at that. Thank you very much. Thunderous applause. At least an audience of one. We're happy to be here. We are Quintessential Brass. It's a lovely day outside. I'm sure it's just as lovely inside. I hope it's lovely wherever you are. Our first two pieces are by someone named John. So the first piece was by John Philip Sousa, very famous band composer from about, a century ago or a little more. He wrote so many marches that not even our band members can keep track of how many are out there. And the name of that one was?
Saber and Spurs.
Saber and Spurs. Yes, we have a winner. Thank you very much. And our next piece is by another man named John. He wrote just dozens and dozens of scores for music, one of the most famous and probably prolific and well-known composers of this day, John Williams. And we're going to play a John Williams medley. You'll hear themes from such movies as Star Wars, E.T., Raiders of the Lost Ark, and if there's any more, be sure and tell me after it's over. Hope you enjoy.
Thank you. We're now going to play a dance for you, a very special dance, a dance that originated in Argentina. And it's a very particular dance because it's a very passionate dance. It's a dance of love and emotions and hate and such. This is called Tango for Jam Jam. The tango is an amazing style of music and has like features of love and hate, good and bad, all sort of mixed together into one big porridge. And this is a piece written for us by Zach Smith, who is a wonderful arranger. And so please enjoy our arrangement of Tango for Jam Jam.
Thank you. Our next tune is from our favorite Peanuts characters, Linus and Lucy. This is written by Vince Guaraldi, and it was released originally back in 1965 for the first Christmas special, Charlie Brown Christmas special. And it went on to be used as the theme music for all of the other Peanuts specials that followed. Enjoy Linus and Lucy.
You lucky folks, ha ha ha! Tis pirate time! Yes, I be a pirate. And in these times, I've unfortunately have to revert it to music because pirating is tough in these times. But for good old memories of all the lovely pirating times, in this lovely town of Beverly. This was a great pirate town. Arr, we're going to play a lovely pirate medley called Pirates of the Caribbean. Thank you.
It seems like I'm introducing the comics. So now we have the theme song from Spider-Man. And this theme originally started, again, back in the 60s, in the mid-60s, the original comic strip animation, which was later remade or made again back in the 90s. Something that I used to watch with my son in the summer on a rainy day. But the theme song has stayed the same all these years, and you'll recognize this theme, and we've got a great arrangement, also by Zach Smith.
Thank you. Back in the early 70s, there was a band called The Mothers of Invention. It was led by my hero, Frank Zappa. And these two guys met in Frank Zappa's band, Lowell George, who's a guitarist, and Bill Payne, who's a keyboardist. And they formed their own band in 1969, a band called Little Feat, which was, Feat is spelled F-E-A-T, as in the Beatles, I think. Anyway, so their biggest hit is a song called Dixie Chicken. So if you know the words, sing along. We do it all, including New Orleans funk. Oh, now we're going to play some more movie music by a guy who was very famous before John Williams, Henry Mancini. And we have his most famous theme from Mr. Lucky TV show, theme from Peter Gunn, Baby Elephant Walk from a movie called Hatari, and Charade. What's that from, Charade? I don't know. Did I miss anything? Anyway, enjoy our Henry Mancini medley.
Thank you.
our mayor, Mike Cahill, and the executive director of our Beverly Council on Aging, Marianne Holak.
Hi, everyone.
And we want to take this opportunity while we have these two folks here to talk a little bit about what's happening to the seniors here in Beverly and how the city is accommodating them and how the things that the Council on Aging is doing. So I have a question that I want to address to both of you. And I guess the first question is, how have the seniors here in Beverly been doing during this pandemic? What kind of issues have they been expressing to you? You know, what is their mood and what is their feeling? And so, Mike, if it's okay with you, I'll go ladies first. And Marianne, you can answer that question first.
Well, thank you, Walt, and Mayor Cahill for being here this evening. I am such a big fan of the seniors in Beverly, and now I have to count myself as one as well. And I think they've been very resilient through this entire pandemic and quarantine period. In the beginning, we heard from a lot of people who needed access to food, and we are so lucky in Beverly to have Beverly Bootstraps. And we're also very lucky to have a partnership with Senior Care, who have been providing Meals on Wheels, added in over 100 new consumers to Meals on Wheels. And also we've been doing a grab-and-go lunch program right from the Senior Center. So people kind of settled into, they figured out how to get their food, whether it was, you know, through the Senior Center or through Bootstraps or through Peapod or Henry's, all wonderful partners during this pandemic. And then they started telling us that they were lonely. So we have matched a lot of seniors up with our staff and some volunteers just to have weekly phone calls. And we tell everybody, you know, call us if you need us. And that means if you just need to talk, you can call us. So again, I'm a big fan of all of our Beverly seniors, and I think you're doing a good job staying the course, even though it's a frustrating time for all of us. And those emotions that you have that are frustrating emotions or sad emotions are pretty normal during the course of this pandemic. But feel free to reach out to the Senior Center whenever you want to talk. We love to hear from you. Thank you.
Yeah, that's spot on. Thanks, Marianne. And hi to everybody. We are going to try to answer a few questions and then get out of the way so you can hear more music. But I would just echo what Marianne said. And really, there's a lot of great work that our Council on Aging staff are doing. And we've got volunteers who are helping out and some volunteers who are waiting for some opportunities to help out. So anybody watching at home who, particularly if you're living alone and you want connections, please make sure you reach out to your neighbors, your friends, your family, but also call us. Call the Senior Center, call my office, because one thing that Marianne and team have started to do as well, in addition to check-in phone calls, is they also have been going out and visiting with people on their front steps, their front porches, or out in their yards. And we're happy to do that. I'm happy to come along and say hi to some of you folks in person. I really miss seeing everybody. So please do that. Reach out to us. You know, call my office at City Hall at 921-6000. Call Marianne at 921-6017. I get that right. And make sure you let us know what you're thinking, what you need. This is, you know, this thought of bringing some music into your living rooms is one that we hope you're enjoying tonight. We'll try to do that again more during the course of the summer. And we'll look for opportunities that we might be able to see you more in person, both whether it be on your front steps or out in public. Please make sure that you keep taking your precautions when you do step out, and that's important to do. And again, we're really glad to be connecting with you tonight. Thanks.
Well, thank you, folks. Marianne, I want to address this question to you. Tell us about the Council on Aging. Have you been open? Are you going to be open soon? And I guess the thing during this pandemic is everything is being done online. Everything is online. Tell us about some of the things that the Council on Aging is doing online.
Thanks, Walt. Well, we have a wonderful online presence thanks to a few younger staff members who have just dug right in and transitioned us over to a Facebook presence, a YouTube presence, and also an online presence where you can watch exercise classes, yoga classes. You can exercise with Gail, you can exercise with Joanne, and you can exercise with Jared. So that's a wonderful opportunity for all of you to get on BevCam or get on YouTube and get your exercise and see some of your favorite instructors. As far as the senior center being open, no, our building is closed to the public, but that doesn't mean the staff haven't been working. We've been actually working overtime during this pandemic, making sure that people have what they need. And, you know, a lot of people don't like that name, senior center, but I think we should call it the connecting center, because we are connecting many people with the resources and the services that they need. And this pandemic has basically highlighted what some of the needs are in our community. Next month, we're going to start a gratitude group online, and we're going to have a book club online talking about Fred Rogers' book, Wonderful Day in the Neighborhood. And you'll find that all in our newsletter. And that's another thing I would say, is we haven't stopped printing a newsletter. The content is a little bit different, but it's interesting, it's informative, and we hope you're enjoying that. You can see it online if you'd like, or you can call us and we'll add your name to our mailing list if you're not already on it. How's that, Walt?
Great, Marianne. Thank you, Marianne. And Mike, outside of the what's been happening at the senior center, what other initiatives has the city taken to help the senior population? And what if seniors feel lonely or they feel out of touch or distressed, which, you know, a lot, it's very easy to do if you're living alone. So tell us a little bit about the things that the city is doing in that regard.
Well, I think what we're really talking about is what the senior center is trying to do, what the Council on Aging is trying to do. And I think, it, you know, what I said before about reaching out and letting us know, I think the in-person check-ins are important. Look, now that the weather is nicer, we can be outdoors and be safe. You know, nothing's changed. The virus is still here. The keys are to keep your distance, wear a face covering, and, you know, wash your hands when you're outside your home and if you're touching any other surfaces. So that really hasn't changed. But the weather is nice, and it's safest, really, to be outdoors if you're going to interact. So, you know, Lynch Park is still there. You can, you know, a lot of people, I've got some of my neighbors who are a little further on in years than me. I see them out walking every day. We have chats. As long as you keep your distance, I think that's really important for people to do. You know, sunshine really is good for a soul, and so is getting the chance to see another smiling face and have a little conversation. So I think those things are important. There are some things upcoming that are, you know, more kind of run-of-the-mill. Although there's nothing run-of-the-mill about elections, you know, we have a state primary on September 1st and a presidential election in November, and so there's early voting that'll be starting up at City Hall in a couple of weeks. And then there's also, I think we've all understood that the voting by mail is now going to be offered. So, you know, different ways for people to participate in elections while trying to keep their distance. And we're also going to have the regular election day, you know, walk into the polling places. So that's fine, and people may choose that. And, you know, as far as what might be available between now and end of summer, I don't want to promise something we can't deliver. But we're talking with the governor and lieutenant governor and their team, and we're paying attention to what might more be able to be offered in person as we go forward. So we'll see how that goes in the next few weeks.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Marianne, did you mention this new thing that you have, curbside service? Can you tell us a little bit about what that means, curbside service?
Well, I have to tell you that the Beverly banks have been so generous to us. We got some money from Eastern Bank and from Institution for Savings. We got some wonderful gifts. And we decided we would take that money and turn it into a curbside visiting program. Let me tell you, our empty building is not a lot of fun to be in. There's not any laughter anymore. We are used to having 200 people a day in our building. So the curbside visits is a way for the staff to get out of the building and to come and visit you at your homes. I went on 6 visits so far, and we only started last week, and we had so much fun just talking, catching up on things. Let me tell you, I visited a 97-year-old woman who was better on the steps than I am, because I'm always worried about that right knee. But she's living alone through this pandemic. She's seen a lot of other things in her lifetime, but she's resilient and she's happy. And because
It's that generation. I already received a thank you note from her. So we don't expect thank you notes for going out to visit our seniors in Beverly who we love, but we'd like to do more of it. So if you want us to come and see you, we'll come and see you. We're bringing popsicles and water bottles and a little gift from the banks. And and one more thing, we're bringing toilet paper too. So we'd love to visit you, and you just need to give us a call and we'll put you on our schedule. It's been really fun. I don't think we're going to ever stop it because it's so much fun. The other thing we have going on is our social worker has been working around the clock, helping people find what they need, including people who are sad and lonely and really need a professional to talk with. So we are also connecting people with some professionals who can help them through some of their sadness and loneliness. So I think that's probably a summary of the curbside visit program.
Thank you, Marianne. And I tell you, the popsicle part sounds great. I can't remember the last time I had a popsicle. Mike, what? Tell us about it. Is City Hall open? Are city services still running normal? And you know, we know that the state and the governor have been running this reopening plan in phases. Where can, if people need information specifically about how Beverly is addressing the reopening plan, where can they get that information? Mike.
Thanks. Well, yeah, I mean, we're working every day. We haven't opened the city buildings to the public yet because of the virus. I would say City Hall will be open for early voting. And I shouldn't have said voting's run of the mill. I think I meant to say it's normal. It's nice to have something that's normal coming our way soon. It's normal that we all, you know, exercise our right to go out and vote. But we will open up for that. We're hoping, and it remains to be seen yet entirely, but we're hoping that school will be able to open in late August. And so we're going to be looking to, in a controlled way, open municipal buildings and operations. I think the senior center is going to be, of necessity, really the last to open, because we know that our seniors have got to pay close attention to the risk that COVID-19 brings. That's one thing. I do want to say that a lot of exciting things are happening because city business is ongoing. Just recently, I was able to bring forward to the city council the special permit request for the Briscoe building. Our old high school become junior high, become middle school, is going to next be senior housing. Now, it's going to take a couple of years to make that happen because the different financing pieces still need to come together for Harborlight Community Partners and Beacon, the two companies that are building. But they're going to rehab Briscoe. It's going to be all preserved. The auditorium is going to be preserved. The whole building, they're going to rebuild those classrooms into apartments. And in another few years, there'll be 85 senior apartments and another handful of artists live workspaces in that building. So, you know, the city council approved that special permit, which is fantastic, which helps that project move forward. We've been doing a lot of construction work during the, during the time when less has been going on out in our streets. And we also have, more and more of our local economy has been able to reopen in different ways that are, being closely monitored and regulated by the state and by our local public health department. So things are happening, and everything needs to happen in the safest way that it possibly can right now. It really, excited that we're able to continue doing things. And we're really kind of stretching our minds hard to figure out how to do more for our senior population, given that we've got to keep you all safe during this time that this new virus is with us before we get the really reliable treatments and the vaccine that is coming. You know, we just don't know how quickly it'll get here. So we're working hard to figure out how to provide more, and we'll keep you posted as we go. Thanks.
And Mike, I have another quick question for you. I'm sure a lot of people are wondering, homecoming, which usually happens this time of year in the next couple of weeks. Tell us about the plans or what we're doing with homecoming this year, please.
So you had asked me about how people can get information about events and reopening, and I forgot to say that. You can go on our website, which is www.beverlyma.gov, so Beverly mass.government, beverlyma.gov. There's a whole Reopen Beverly site that you can click to from there. They can give you a lot of information. As far as your question about the state, Yeah, I mean, we talk. I'm on several meetings a week with different groups of mayors and town managers and state agency secretaries and commissioners. We do speak with the lieutenant governor weekly. I get together with a bunch of other mayors on multiple occasions throughout the course of a given week, just to share information and brainstorm. The state has been in phases, right, trying to reopen in a way that's safe. And I really credit Governor Baker and his team with trying to be very thoughtful, recognizing that if you reopen everything all at once, you're not going to get good results. And we've seen that happen in some other states. So they're real. They just continue to track. What we're paying most attention to is hospitalizations for COVID. They've been down very low. I mean, things kind of surged forward and got to their peak in late April, and they've been going down ever since. And so we're trying to do things, and the state's trying to do things. We're working as in partnership with them to try to make sure that as we reopen things, it's done thoughtfully, and the number of people who get sick with COVID doesn't really spike. It's keeping it down low, and we have the benefit of the good weather and the ability to hopefully to do more outside without getting too close, right, and keeping that distance and practicing that both distance, face covering, and hand washing, which there's nothing more important than that right now, right, in terms of keeping ourselves safe. So,
homecoming.
Oh, homecoming. So homecoming won't happen the way it typically happens. It's, you know, it just can't. Because most of the, well, think about it, both homecoming and generally summertime events are historically, traditionally all about bringing as many people as we can together in the same space to eat, to drink, to listen to music, to dance, to play cribbage, you know, to really, you know, socialize and have fun together. That's what most of those events do, really, all of those events do. So we're not really able to do homecoming. It's just, it's the reality right now. That's why I say we're really working kind of day in and day out, watching what the governor is able to allow and what can fit within that. And, you know, we'll be staying in touch with you and through you to, and, you know, directly as well to our community and especially to our seniors to try to figure out what we can offer between now and the end of the summer. And it's really all governed by what can be done safely.
Thanks. Yeah. And I don't know, Bruce Doig is sitting out there in front of me out in the, on the lawn, and he's the big guy that that takes care of homecoming. That's his thing. So I guess you'll have a lot of free time on his hands, won't you, Bruce, this summer?
Oh, no, he's still busy.
See that? I'm sorry, Bruce.
Everything that the state says we can do comes with 5 pages of restrictions and regulations. So he's still
sorry I brought it up, Bruce. Well, I want to thank our mayor, Mike Cahill, Your Honor. Thank you for your comments.
And Marianne,
And Marianne Holak as well, who's the executive director of the Beverly Council on Aging. And now we will hand it back to Quintessential Brass. Yes.
Awesome. All right, we are back. We are the Quintessential Brass Quintet, and we are very glad to be here and playing music together. As you know, it's been quite some time since we've been able to perform in ensembles, and just getting these little moments means more to us than you might think. You just heard a piece composed by Danny Elfman, which was the theme song to The Simpsons, which was a satirical cartoon, which was a very progressive cartoon for its time, and it's still going. It's in its 30th season this year. And it kind of gave way for other sitcoms to come in, cartoons such as Family Guy, South Park, American Dad, all those other cartoons we see now that follow that satirical nature. Up next, we have another piece by John Philip Sousa. This march is very unique because it's in minor. Not all marches are in a minor key. This one is entitled Nobles of the Mystic Shrine. We hope you enjoy.
And now we're going to move to one of my favorite eras of music, the swing era. And this next person really epitomized even more than the swing era, the jazz era, the swing era. So much his music is still bright and fresh today as it was when he wrote it. I'm talking about Duke Ellington, or Edward Kennedy Ellington. He was an amazing a piano player and band leader. And he started out in the early, like in the 20s, and at the Cotton Club. And he had an amazing band of individuals. And this is a piece that would feature Bubba Miley, who was an expert in using the plunger. This thing here, you know what it's usually used for. Well, you can also use it for this. Yeah. and that was the sound that was sort of for publicity purposes labeled the jungle sound. And there were some other amazing proponents of that plunger work, like Rain Ants and Clark Terry and such. And this one is called East St. Louis Toodaloo. So please enjoy our Duke Ellington feature, East St. Louis Toodaloo.
Well, next we've got a medley of the service songs to celebrate and honor those who have served and those who are serving. We've got the five service songs in a medley. Enjoy.
I was just asking.
Which one would you rather play, Big Band or the other one?
Or You'll Never Walk Alone?
Yeah, which one? You got time for one.
We'll try You'll Never Walk Alone.
Okay. You can denounce that one.
Okay.
It's our last tune.
Now, I don't know anything about who wrote it.
It's okay.
It's got a message.
Rodgers and Hammerstein?
Well, now, as usually happens at the end of a concert, we've come to our last tune, and we're going to play a very beautiful one that's appropriate for this time. You'll Never Walk Alone. This is arranged by Gary Schlechter, and it's an inspiring piece, so please enjoy. And thank you so much for listening and coming along. We'll hopefully see you soon.
Thank you.
The quintessential brass, ladies and gentlemen. Let's give them a big hand. Great, great work, guys. And on behalf of the mayor and the senior center, I'd like to thank all our viewers for tuning in this evening. And I'm told by the mayor that this might not be the last remote concert that we do this summer for the enjoyment of the citizens of Beverly. So thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you next time.